Good morning. Today we are going to review momentum, impulse, collisions, and center of mass as a part of the AP Physics C Mechanics curriculum.
Flippin' physics!
Bo, what is the equation for momentum?
Momentum equals mass times velocity.
We should point out momentum is a lowercase p, power is an uppercase p.
And momentum and velocity are vectors.
And the units for momentum are kilograms, meters per second.
And the units have no special name, they are just kilogram, meters per second, unlike newtons, which are kilograms, meters per second squared.
Okay.
Billy, what is Newton's second law in terms of momentum?
The sum of the forces acting on an object or system of objects equals the derivative of the momentum of that object or system of objects with respect to time.
Don't forget, force and momentum are vectors.
Yeah.
Because momentum equals mass times velocity, we can use the product rule to get net force equals the derivative of mass with respect to time times velocity, plus mass times the derivative of velocity with respect to time. And we know the derivative of velocity with respect to time equals acceleration. Therefore, Bobby, when we used the net force equals mass times acceleration as Newton's second law, what were we assuming?
Well, that would mean the derivative of mass with respect to time was zero.
Sure, Bobby, but what does that really mean about the object?
Oh, that means the mass of the object is not changing. I get it. Net force equals mass times acceleration assumes the mass of the object is constant.
Billy, when can we use conservation of momentum?
We can use conservation of momentum when all the forces are internal to the system.
That is correct, but can you prove it?
Sure. If all the forces are internal to the system, then the sum of the external forces acting on the system equals zero, and the derivative of the momentum of the system with respect to time equals zero. And if the derivative of the momentum of the system with respect to time equals zero, then the momentum of the system is not changing as a function of time. So the sum of the initial momenta equals the sum of the final momenta.
It is also useful to realize momentum is conserved during all collisions and explosions.
Because all the forces are internal to the system during collisions and explosions.
Now let's derive the equation for impulse, which is often called the Impulse-Momentum Theorem. We start by looking at the net force acting on an object, and using the equation we were just working with, we can rearrange that to get net force times dt is equal to dp, and then we can take the definite integral of the whole equation. The limits when taking the integral with respect to time go from time initial to time final, and the limits when taking the integral with respect to momentum go from momentum initial to momentum final. The definite integral of 1 with respect to momentum is momentum final minus momentum initial, which is change in momentum. In other words, the change in momentum equals the definite integral from time initial to time final of the net force with respect to time, which is defined as impulse. And the symbol for impulse is a capital J, and impulse, just like momentum, is a vector. Because impulse is force times time, the units for impulse are Newton's seconds.
Mr. P?
And yes, Billy. The units for impulse, Newton's seconds, are equivalent to the units for momentum, kilogram meters per second.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah, I know. Remember, integrals are the area under the curve. Therefore, impulse is the area between the net force as a function of time curve and the horizontal time axis, where area above the time axis is positive and area below the time axis is negative. Also, do not confuse impulse with work. Work is the definite integral of force with respect to position, not time. The two equations are very similar to one another. Okay, Bo, what is the impulse approximation?
The impulse approximation is where we can say the force of impact during the collision is so large that it overshadows all the other forces, and therefore the net force is approximately equal to the force of impact during the collision. That is true with large forces of impact, which usually last for a short time interval.
Sadly, impact force and impulse often get confused with one another. Perhaps it's because they both start with imp? I don't know. If we can consider the force of impact to be constant, or we have the average force of impact, the impulse is equal to the average force of impact times the change in time. This gives us a rectangle with the same area as the definite integral impulse equation. Now let's review the types of collisions. Bobby, please explain this table.
This table lists two types of collisions, elastic and inelastic. Momentum is conserved during all types of collisions, so the difference between elastic and inelastic collisions is whether kinetic energy is conserved. And kinetic energy is conserved during elastic collisions, and kinetic energy is not conserved during inelastic collisions.
What about perfectly inelastic collisions?
Yes, a perfectly inelastic collision is where the two objects run into one another and stick together afterwards. I've also seen a perfectly inelastic collision referred to as a completely or totally inelastic collision. Be aware that collisions between hard spheres are considered to be elastic collisions generally in physics classes. And in the real world, most collisions are actually inelastic, where some kinetic energy is converted to heat and sound during the collisions. Okay, next let's talk about center of mass. The position of the center of mass of a system of particles is equal to the sum of the mass of each particle multiplied by the location of each particle, all divided by the total mass of the system. In other words, if we are solving for the center of mass of a system of particles in the x direction, that is equal to the mass of object 1 multiplied by the x position of object 1 relative to a zero reference line, which often is but does not have to be the origin, plus the mass of object 2 times the location of object 2, again in the x direction relative to the zero reference line, plus however many objects we have, we repeat that many times, all divided by the total mass of the system of particles. The velocity of the center of mass of a system of particles is equal to the derivative of the position of the center of mass of the system of particles with respect to time. And because the mass of the system of particles does not change, and the derivative of position with respect to time is velocity, the equation for the velocity of the center of mass of a system of particles is almost identical to the equation for the position of the center of mass of a system of particles. You simply replace position with velocity. And we can do the same thing to determine the acceleration of the center of mass of a system of particles. Because the derivative of velocity with respect to time is acceleration, the equation for the acceleration of the center of mass of a system of particles is almost identical to the equation for the velocity of the center of mass of a system of particles. You simply replace velocity with acceleration. Now, realize the only one of these three equations which is on the AP equation sheet which you're going to get on the exam is the equation for the position center of the center of mass of a system of particles. The equations for velocity and acceleration of the center of mass of a system of particles are not on the AP equation sheet. Now let's talk about finding the center of mass of a rigid system of particles, or what is more commonly called a rigid object with shape. The position of the center of mass of a rigid object with shape is equal to 1 over the total mass of the object times the integral with respect to mass of the location of all of those infinitesimally small pieces of that object, which are called dm, relative to a zero reference line.
Could you please say that again?
Yeah, please.
What is r?
Sure, I'll start with r. Now, R is a position vector, just like we used in kinematics, and it describes the position of an object in 1, 2, or 3-dimensional space. And so here it's describing the location of all of these dms. And when we're figuring out the position center of mass, we usually only determine that in 1-dimensional space, so we usually replace it with something we're more familiar with, like x. So in this case, x is defined as in the same way it was for a system of particles. It is the location of all of the different pieces of the system. In this case, the system is the object, so we break the object into an infinitely large number of infinitesimally small pieces dm.
That's right. That's what an integral is.
Exactly. That is what an integral is. And This particular integral is not on your AP equation sheet. I don't know why, it's just not there.
That does not help me out at all.
I know. Okay, so on to more things which are not on the AP equation sheet. Volumetric mass density equals the mass of the object divided by its volume. The symbol for volumetric mass density is the lowercase Greek letter rho. And just so you know, I put a slash through my V for volume to distinguish volume from velocity. Surface mass density is the mass of the object divided by its surface. And the symbol for surface mass density is the lowercase Greek letter sigma. And linear mass density equals the mass of the object divided by its length. And the symbol for linear mass density is the lowercase Greek letter lambda.
Did he really say none of those are on the equation sheet?
Yep.
Oh.
He did.
These equations for density tend to be helpful when determining the center of mass of rigid objects with shape. Although I will admit that sigma, the surface mass density, I have yet to see be used in AP Physics C mechanics. However, in AP Physics C electricity and magnetism, the surface charge density is used, and I thought y'all should start getting used to it.
Thank you.
Sure.
That completes my review of momentum, impulse, collisions, and center of mass. Next, feel free to enjoy my review of rotational kinematics for AP Physics C mechanics, or you could visit my AP Physics C review webpage. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.